Today's topic is orthogonal coordinates. And operators. Much of this material you have studied in previous courses, but it's so central to this course that it's really worth our while to spend a lecture reviewing it. And some of the material, for example, when we talk about general orthogonal coordinate systems, will probably be new. Let's start off with a review of the idea of the derivative of a function, d by dx of f of x. We can define this as the limit as some parameter h goes to 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x over h. Graphically, imagine we have in the xy plane, a function y is equal to f of x. Then at some particular value of x, we can step a distance h to the right and look at the value of the function at these two points, f of x and f of x plus h. And this definition says that if we look at the slope of the line through those two points, and the slope being the rise over the run here, delta y over delta x, and delta y here would be the change in the function f, that as h goes to 0 and these two points become infinitesimally close, then the slope of that line is the same as the slope of the tangent to the curve. So that's the normal derivative. Now the same idea can be applied to functions of multiple variables if we just focus on one variable at a time. So we could, for example, look at the partial derivative with respect to y of the function f of x and y. So we're only interested in y variations, so we keep x fixed. So we'll define this to be the limit as h goes to 0, f of x, and we'll increment y plus h, minus f of x, y divided by h. So we treat x as a constant in this case, and we just vary the one variable, and it's the same idea. But we use this curly d notation to distinguish this from the normal derivative. Of course, if we have two variables, x and y, we could also take a partial derivative with respect to the other variable, x. Partial with respect to x of f of x and y would be, same idea, the limit as h goes to 0. And now we vary x, f of x plus h and y, minus f of x and y all over h. To represent this graphically, we might try to represent the function f of x and y as z is equal to f of x and y, where z is the distance out of the page. And so we might use the idea that you use in a topographic map where you have contours of constant z, constant elevation. Maybe something like this. And then if this is our point x and y, to get the partial derivative with respect to x, we step a distance here. This is x and x plus h. So we do an offset in the x direction. To get the partial derivative with respect to y, we would do the same thing, but stepping with respect to y. Okay, so we'd have these two orthogonal directions. We can get derivatives in either direction. Of course, looking at this picture, it seems clear that you could also get a derivative with respect to any direction from 0 to 360 degrees in the xy plane. What would that be the derivative of? Okay, so we'll make this concrete here in a minute. It can be defined, the derivative in any direction, we call the directional derivative, as a function of these two partial derivatives. Now, it gets a little bit tiresome to put this curly D over curly D type notation when you're writing by hand, even when you're printing in text. So we'll use very often the shorthand notation that curly D sub X is by definition a shorthand for the partial derivative with respect to X. So then we can say curly D sub X of F. And it all fits nicely on one line. You know from your calculus classes that you can take the derivative of the derivative. We call that the second derivative. If you do that for a function of multiple variables, those derivatives can be mixed. That is, we could have something like the second partial derivative with respect to y, with respect to x, of f of x and y. So, let's see, this would be the limit as h goes to 0 of, well, this is the partial derivative with respect to y of the partial derivative with respect to x. So we take the partial derivative with respect to x, and we're going to vary y here. So we'll have this at x and y plus h minus the partial derivative with respect to x at x and y divided by h. So that would be the partial derivative with respect to y of the partial derivative with respect to x. But now let's put in the variation of f with respect to x to get the x derivatives. And so assuming we can do that with the same limit here, we would write this first term as f of, so we take this argument and we're going to vary x. So x plus h y plus h minus f of x y plus h over h, that's the x derivative here, and then minus the same thing about x and y. So we'll take f of, we're going to vary x, x plus h and y minus f of x and y divided by h, and then that difference over h. And so what does that look like? The limit as h goes to 0 of, let's rearrange these a little bit. This will be f of x plus h y plus h plus f of x and y, right? Because you have here minus minus f of x and y becomes plus f of x and y. And then we've got minus f x y plus h and minus f x plus h y. And that will all be over then h times h, or h squared. And if we look at that in the xy plane, that would involve the point x and y, and that with an offset in x, and that with an offset in y, and that with an offset in both x and y. So it would be involved these four points where this is h here. And let's see, we have plus signs for this here and that one there, and the other two we have minus signs. Well, if you went through and did that, but you took the partial derivatives in the opposite order, so you did second partial derivative with respect to x and y of f of x and y, you would end up with exactly the same arrangement of points with the same signs. So this tells us that mixed partial derivatives do not depend on the order in which we take the derivatives. We can take the x derivative first and then the y derivative, or vice versa. When we write a normal derivative, df dx, say, one interpretation of this is that it is the rate of change of f with respect to x. Now suppose we have a function f of x, y, and z. Okay, so this is defined throughout three-dimensional space here, x, y, and z. Maybe f is temperature as a function of position. You can imagine taking a temperature sensor and having it fly along some trajectory, a trajectory defined by x of t, y of t, and z of t, which we might then write as vector r, position vector, as a function of time. Then the temperature sensed along that trajectory would become a one-dimensional function of time, f of t, which would be f of x of t, y of t, and z of t. Well, now we have a function of a single variable. So we can take a standard derivative, df dt. And what is that in terms of f of x, y, and z? So you learned this in your multivariable calculus class. We use the chain rule for partial derivatives. It is the partial of f with respect to x times the rate of change of x with respect to time, plus the partial of f with respect to y times the rate of change of y with respect to time, plus the partial of f with respect to z times the rate of change of z with respect to time. And if we imagine multiplying through by the differential dt, we would end up then with an expression for the variation in f, df would be, and using our shorthand, this would be the x partial of f times dx plus the y partial of f times dy plus the z partial of f times dz. This has the form of an inner product or dot product between two vectors. The first vector we'll write as x partial of f, y partial of f, z partial of f, dot, the second vector we'll write as dx, dy, dz. And this leads us to define a differential operator applied to the function f, which we call the gradient. The gradient of f is this first vector, the x derivative of f, y derivative of f, the z derivative of f. And then this little increment here we could call a differential vector displacement dl. And then we would have the expression df is the gradient of f dot dl. So what would dl be? Well, on the curve here, dl would be a little displacement, which has a direction and a magnitude. We could write that as, let's call this A hat times the length DL. And so therefore, DF would be the gradient of F dot this unit vector, A hat, times the displacement DL. And this would define then DF with respect to DL, the rate of change of F with respect to length, in an arbitrary direction in space, because this, then we could take a different path where this unit vector went in some different direction in space. And now the gradient then is what formalizes that idea that we saw on the previous board, that we could have derivatives with respect to arbitrary directions in space. So the gradient dot a unit vector gives us the rate of change of the function with respect to distance along that direction. So, the rate of change of F with respect to distance, we've seen, is the gradient of F dot a unit vector A. So let's go back to a two-dimensional kind of picture here, where at some point x, y here, and we can use an arbitrary unit vector, angle from 0 to 360 degrees, and we'll get different rates of change of the function with respect to distance in those directions. In what direction will that rate of change be as big as possible? Well, this will be max if the unit vector is parallel to the gradient. The gradient is some vector. So at some particular point in space, there will be some vector which is the gradient of F at that point. And obviously, if our unit vector is parallel to that, we'll get the greatest inner product. And so we can say this, that the magnitude of the gradient, right, which is what we would get here if we just dot product this with a unit vector A, we get the magnitude of this times the magnitude of that. This magnitude of the A hat is 1, so you just get the magnitude of the gradient, is the max value of df dl. You can think of that, if you think of f of x and y is equal to z is like a topo map, this would be the uphill direction. The gradient points uphill. It tells you where, for every step you take, you will get the maximum increase in elevation. So the direction of the gradient is in the direction uphill, and the magnitude is the rate of change of the function with respect to distance in that direction. If you go in other directions, well, then you, for example, if I go perpendicular, if I take my A hat to be perpendicular, then gradient of F dot A is 0, and I would be on a level curve then in terms of topography. And if I go, of course, in the opposite direction, anti-parallel to gradient of F, I would be going downhill, and then DF DL would be negative, I'd be decreasing. Okay, so the gradient of F, we think of it as pointing uphill. Of course, that gets a little abstract in more than two dimensions, but that's the idea. And moreover, with the gradient of F being able to be written as AX hat X derivative of F plus AY hat Y derivative of F plus AZ hat Z derivative of F, this is suggestive of writing what we call the del operator as A hat X partial with respect to X plus A hat Y partial with respect to Y plus A hat Z partial with respect to Z. And then gradient of F is just applying the del operator to the function F. Now obviously this del operator has no value unless you actually allow it to operate on some function. So that's why we call it an operator. But this is a useful way to think about the operation of the del operator, because we're going to have different operations we can do with this same operator, as we'll see. If we take the dot product of the del operator and a vector field A, so the del operator would be partial x, partial y, partial z, and A would have components ax, ay, az, and then that dot product would formally then be partial x of ax plus partial y of ay plus partial z of az. And we call that the divergence of the vector field A. If we imagine some closed surface S which bounds a volume V, then we can define the surface flux. We use psi to represent this. The surface flux through the surface S, closed surface, would be the integral of A dot ds. Or as we go to any point here, there's a little surface patch with surface normal times surface area. Let me put it here. Equal to ds, and we dot that in with the value of A at that point, and integrate that up over the entire surface. Then the divergence theorem tells us that that is equal to the volume integral of the divergence of A dv. If we imagine taking that volume to be very, very small, so that the divergence of A is approximately constant within that volume, then this would just say that over that little area, that the surface flux would be basically divergence of A dv. So that we could think of the divergence in that sense is surface flux per unit volume. So the bigger the divergence is, the larger the surface flux through a little surface surrounding that little volume would be. And then the divergence theorem is just a matter of just adding that up over a macroscopic volume. To see where the divergence theorem comes from, imagine we have, here's x, y, and z, and we imagine a little rectangular box, and it has dimensions dx, dy, and dz. And we're interested in the flux through the left and right faces. So in that case, right, the surface normal of the left and right face will be parallel to the z-axis, the a hat z. And so only the az component of the vector field will produce flux through those surfaces. So here at the left, we'll have a flux into the box of az times the area dx dy. Okay, so normal component of the vector field times the area. Over here on the right, what do we have? Well, we'll have that same expression, however it changes when we move a little distance dz. So we'll write that as, it'll be the original value, az dx dy, plus whatever the change is in moving a certain distance z. So partial with respect to z, of az dx dy times the change in z, dz. And then we'll take the difference of these, because this will be a flux out and this will be a flux in. So the net flux out will be the difference. This minus that. And of course, that'll just lead to these two terms canceling. And so the net flux for the left and right surfaces will be, well, let's see, dx and dy don't change with respect to z. So this will just be the z derivative of az times dx dy dz. And if we do that for the other four faces, we'll end up with the x derivative of ax plus the y derivative of ay plus the z derivative of az times dx dy dz, and that's just dv, the volume. So that's why, if we add that up for all the different faces, we're going to get then that the surface flux is equal to this, which is the divergence times the volume. Okay, and then if you just integrate that for a large macroscopic volume, then you get the divergence theorem. So another way to think about this is, right, this here is the divergence, and we could then say that the divergence is just the rate of change of surface flux with respect to volume. If we take the cross product of the del operator and a vector field, so here's the del operator, d by dx, or partial x, partial y, partial z, cross ax, ay, az, and that would be, using our formula for the cross product from the previous lecture, a hat x times partial y of az minus partial z of ay plus ay hat partial z of ax minus partial x of az plus az hat partial x of ay minus partial y of ax. And we call that the curl of the vector field A. And the reason for that name comes from Stokes' theorem, which tells us that, imagine we have some arbitrary loop here, and that loop bounds a surface S. Now the surface doesn't have to be flat. It could be, and of course the loop L could be arbitrarily shaped, so it doesn't maybe fit in a plane. And S could be any surface which is bounded by that loop. Then Stokes' theorem tells us that the integral around the loop of A dot dl, so here would be a little line element dl there, that is equal to the integral over the bounded surface of the curl of A dot ds. So here we have a little directed surface element, and the relation here is it follows the right-hand rule. So if you put your fingers in the direction that you're integrating for the line integral, then your thumb goes in the direction of the, more or less, of the surface normals. If you shrink this down to a very small little disk, say, then if you orient that disk in space such that you get the maximum circulation, in other words, you get the, well, let's draw it this way. Here's A, say. If you get the maximum a.dl around that little disk, that is going to be approximately equal to the magnitude of the curl of A times the little area ds. And we call that integral of a.dl around a loop the circulation, or the rotation. And so from this picture here, you can see that the magnitude of the curl of A really gives you the circulation per unit area. And the direction is the direction of maximum circulation. You can imagine having a little disk like this, and when you can orient it in different directions in space, and for some direction, you're going to get the maximum circulation that defines the direction of the curl of A, and the magnitude of curl A is the actual circulation divided by the area of the little disk. To understand where Stokes' theorem comes from, let's imagine we're in the xy plane here, and we draw a little rectangular box with dimensions dx and dy. And we want to calculate the integral around that box of ADL, the circulation around that little box. So let's see, down here on the bottom, we're moving in the x direction. So the component we get from a.dx would be the x component. So we get ax. On the left side here, we're moving up and down in the y direction. So the tangential component would be ay. And likewise, on the top, we'd also have the x component would be tangential. But now, whatever value ax we have here on the bottom, it's going to change because we are moving a distance dy up along the y-axis. So we get ax plus the derivative with respect to y of ax times the change in y dy. And on the right side, we'd have ay plus its change due to a displacement dx. So x derivative of ay dx. And now we can calculate the circulation around this little box. Let's start down here. Here we get ax dx. Going up on this side, we get plus ay plus partial x ay dx times the height dy. Up on the top, let's see, now we're integrating from right to left, so we're going against this value, so that'll give us a minus sign, so minus ax plus partial y ax dy, and the distance is delta dx. And then on the left, we're going down, so we're going against the ay there, so we get minus ay, and the distance is dy. Now, let's see. Here we've got ax dx, and here we've got a minus ax dx, so that cancels with that. Here we've got an ay dy, and here a minus ay dy, so that cancels with that. And that leaves, in the first case, we've got x derivative of ay times dx dy minus here the y derivative of ax dx dy. So we factor out the dx dy, and that is simply the z component of the curl of A. And this, of course, is your ds, the area of the little box. And so if you repeat that for the not just the xy plane, but also the yz plane and the zx planes, you get all three components of the curl of A, and you'll see that it's related to the circulation by the curl of A in the direction of the surface normal gives you the circulation per unit area. If we take the divergence of the gradient of a scalar field F. We get what's called a Laplacian. We represent that as del squared F. And what would that be? Let's see. So the divergence, right, that's the del operator, partial X, partial Y, partial Z, dot the gradient of F, which is partial X, F, partial Y, F, partial Z, F, and you do the dot, you're going to get partial X of partial X, F, plus partial Y, F, etc. So you're going to get the sum of the second derivatives. Second with respect to X of F, plus second with respect to Y of F, plus the second with respect to Z of F. That is the Laplacian. You probably came across Laplace's equation in your previous studies. Laplacian of F is equal to zero. So let's get a little feeling for what the Laplacian represents. And to do that, let's start off by talking about what the second derivative can be thought to represent. So say here's X and Y, and we've got some function, right? Y is equal to F of X. And we go here at some point, X, we go back here a distance h to the left, and over here a distance h to the right. So we've got F of X plus h and F of X minus h. So the second derivative of F with respect to X, of course, is the derivative with respect to X of the derivative of F with respect to X. So let's go over here in between these two points. And so this would be at X plus h over 2. And let's approximate the derivative at that point by the slope of that line. And then let's go over here to this point, which would be x minus h over 2, and approximate the derivative at that point by the slope of that line. Then if we take the difference of those two slopes and divide by this distance, which is h, we would get an approximation for the second derivative, that is the derivative of the derivative. So what would that look like? So we use the double prime notation here. So let's see. So we'll take the derivative at x plus h over 2 is approximately f of x plus h minus f of x over h, that's the slope of this line here, and then minus the slope of the previous line, which is f of x minus f of x minus h over h, and then that whole thing over h. And what is that? Let's see. That would be equal to, we've got an f of x plus h, then a minus minus f of x minus h. So that would be f of x plus h plus f of x minus h, and then a minus f of x minus f of x. So that would be minus 2 f of x over h times h, over h squared. So we have the sum of the two, right, we're interested in the second derivative here at the point x. So we have the sum of the two neighboring values, f of x minus h, f of x plus h, minus twice the value at the point in question divided by h squared. So applying that idea to the second derivative with respect to y and with respect to z and adding them, we would get that the Laplacian, the sum of these second derivatives, would be approximately equal to 1 over h squared. And then we would get, for the x second derivative, we would get the neighboring points in x, f of x plus h y z plus f of x minus h y z. And for the y second derivative, we get the neighboring points in y plus h z plus f of x y minus h z. And then for the z second derivative, we would get the neighboring points in z x y z plus h plus f of x y z minus h. And then for each one of those, we get minus 2 times f at the point in question. And we've got that 3 times, so that would be 2 times 3 would be 6 f of x, y, and z. So if we pull out a factor of 6, so let's do that here. Make this minus 6, put a 6 up here. And these are all then divided by 6. We can see what that would be equal to. It would be 6 over h squared. And let's call this average here, we'll call it fh. And then this is just, we'll call just f at the point in question. And of course, if we let h go to 0, then that would become the exact definition of the Laplacian. So it's 6 over h squared. This fh is just the average value of the function a distance h away. So the Laplacian measures the difference between the field or the function at a point and the average of its neighbors, which are a distance h away. And in the limit that h goes to 0, that becomes the exact definition. So we can write that Laplacian of f is the limit as h goes to 0 of 6 over h squared f of h minus f. And a little extra analysis along these lines tells you that indeed you could think of f sub h as not just the average of these 6 points, but the average over an entire sphere of radius h. So you can think of the Laplacian as, here's a point, you go to a sphere of radius h, you calculate fh, the average value on that sphere of the function, and then subtract the function value at the center times 6 over h squared in the limit. That is what your Laplacian is. So if Laplace's equation holds, it says that at every point in your field, the field value is equal to the average value of its neighbors. And so you can kind of understand why in nature a lot of fields would satisfy Laplace's equation, because nature in some sense wants things to be as smooth or as averaged as possible. So that's the Laplacian. In rectangular coordinates, only, there is a vector identity, which you will partly verify in the homework. The curl of A is equal to the gradient of the divergence of A, which is another kind of messy expression, minus an expression that can be interpreted as the Laplacian of the vector A. We've defined the Laplacian of a scalar. What's the Laplacian of a vector? Well, in rectangular coordinates, Laplacian of a vector has an x component, which is the Laplacian of the x component of A, has a y component, which is the Laplacian of the y component of A, and a z component, which is the Laplacian of the z component of A. This is in rectangular coordinates only. In any other coordinate system, we define, well, let's take this to be the definition of the Laplacian of a vector in rectangular coordinates. In other coordinates, we define the Laplacian from this identity. So we turn this around and write it as the gradient of the divergence of A minus the curl of the curl of A. Now let's talk about the idea of orthogonal coordinates in general. Most science and engineering analysis is done in rectangular coordinates, where position vector is x, y, z, which we can also write as unit vector ax hat times x plus ay hat times y plus a hat z times z. However, you have probably learned about two other coordinate systems, cylindrical coordinates. Define x as rho cosine phi, y as rho sine phi, and z as z. So cylindrical coordinates would have coordinate values rho, phi, and z. And you have probably studied spherical coordinates. And in spherical coordinates, we define x to be r sine theta cosine phi, y to be r sine theta sine phi, and z to be r cosine theta. So spherical coordinates are r, theta, and phi. Why do we have different coordinate systems? Well, we'll see this very much in this course. When you're trying to solve problems analytically, very often the real problem becomes describing the fields or the conditions on boundaries. So the natural boundaries in rectangular coordinates would be things like boxes. All right, so x is a constant, y is a constant, z is a constant, something like a box or a plane. In cylindrical coordinates, well, the natural boundary would be, for example, cylinders. It could also be half planes. In spherical coordinates, well, the natural boundaries would be spheres. It could also be cones, theta. This would be theta is equal to a constant. This would be r is equal to a constant. And this would be rho is equal to a constant. And this would be variations of x, y, z are equal to constants. So if you want to solve a problem that has or is based on a more or less a rectangular types of geometries for the boundary of the regions where you're trying to solve, say, Maxwell's equations, rectangular coordinates are the ones to use. If you're trying to solve for the fields in, let's say, a fiber optic cable, which is a cylindrical structure, cylindrical coordinates are what you want to use. If you have spherical boundaries, spherical coordinates, or you have conical boundaries, spherical coordinates can be the ones that you want to use. But more generally, you might have some other types of boundaries. One of the problems we'll study is the problem of two parallel wires. Something that looks like this. Parallel wire transmission line. Well, if I had just one wire, that would be a cylinder. I could use cylindrical coordinates. For two wires, we'll use what are called bipolar cylindrical coordinates. And by the way, cylindrical coordinates would be probably more precisely notated as circular cylindrical coordinates, because the cross-section of the cylinder here is a circle. So let's look at the idea of defining an arbitrary coordinate system. And in particular, we want these coordinates to have the problem, or the property, rather, of orthogonality. We'll define what that means. Now imagine we're going to describe position in three-dimensional space using coordinates u, v, and w. Well, one way we could do this would follow the example for cylindrical and spherical coordinates, would be to define the rectangular coordinates x, y, and z as functions of u, v, and w. So x, say, is equal to a function x of u, v, and w. Y is equal to a function y of u, v, and w. And z is a function z of u, v, and w. Then vector position r is unit vector in the x direction, a hat x, times the function x of u, v, w, plus unit vector a hat y times the function y, u, v, w, plus a hat z times the function z of u, v, w. And now we can think about how position changes when we change the coordinates u, v, or w. We can define the vector partial derivative with respect to u of position r, and that will be a hat x partial u of x, meaning the partial derivative of this function x of u, v, and w, plus a hat y partial u of y plus a hat z partial u of z. And we can do the same thing, taking a derivative with respect to v. Partial v with respect to x, a hat y partial v with respect to y, a hat z partial v with respect to z, and then a partial with respect to w of r, a hat x partial w of x, a hat y partial w of y, a hat z partial w of z. So this would be where we're at some point r, and say we vary parameter u, we'll get a derivative, and that'll be a vector, which will be partial with respect to u of r. And so we'll define unit coordinate vectors. A hat u will be, by definition, that vector partial u with respect to position over the norm of that vector, so that we're making it a unit vector. And a hat v will be the partial with respect to v of position over its norm. And a hat w will be the partial with respect to w of position over its norm. So these three unit vectors then are the unit coordinate vectors. If our unit coordinate vectors are everywhere mutually orthogonal, so that a hat u dot a hat v is equal to a hat u dot a hat w is equal to a hat v dot a hat w is equal to zero, then we say that we have orthogonal coordinates. And this means that if we go to any point in space and we look at the unit vectors corresponding to the coordinates, so here's a hat u, a hat v, and a hat w, they will form a set of three orthogonal vectors. Now, if we go to somewhere else in space, we'll still get three orthogonal vectors, but they may not be parallel to what they were over at this other point. So here maybe is your a hat u, a hat v, and a hat w somewhere else. But they will always be mutually orthogonal. And that's a very important property. If you have non-orthogonal coordinates, the mathematical complexity grows tremendously. It'll be enough for us just to deal with orthogonal coordinates. Now we defined, remember the unit vector a hat u, we defined that to be the partial derivative with respect to u of position divided by the norm of that vector. And those norms have important physical significance. They tell us how far we move, the distance we move, for a unit change in the corresponding coordinate. So we're going to define quantities that we're going to call the scale factors. H sub u is, by definition, the norm of the partial derivative of u with respect partial derivative with respect to u of position. And h sub v is the norm of the partial derivative with respect to v of position. And h sub w is defined to be the norm of the partial derivative with respect to w of position. So these are the scale factors. The significance then, combining that with the idea that the unit vectors are mutually orthogonal, would be that if I go to some position in space and I vary my u-coordinate, say, by du, well, the distance corresponding to that variation will be h sub u du. And if I vary my v-coordinate by dv, well, that distance will be h sub v dv. And if I vary my w coordinate by dw, that distance will be h sub w dw. And if I add up all those variations, right, I take the vector sum of all those, I will get a distance we'll call dl, which, well, it'll just be given by the Pythagorean theorem. So this would just be like moving a certain distance in x, a certain distance in y, a certain distance in z. The total distance squared would be the sum of the squares of those displacements. So dl squared then will be equal to hu squared du squared plus hv squared dv squared plus hw squared dw squared. And so that allows us to convert changes in coordinates to spatial displacements. By the way, if we were to use non-orthogonal coordinates that did not have this perpendicular property, then we would get expressions that would look like dl squared would be GUU DU squared plus GUV DU DV plus GUW DU DW plus, and so on, we would get 9 terms instead of 3 terms. And they'd have all these cross terms, these DU DV, DU DW, DV DW type terms. And this would be massively more complicated than the problems we're trying to solve. So if we have only orthogonal coordinates, then we get this nice Pythagorean form for the distance we move when we change the coordinate values by DU, DV, and DW. Now we can work out what our various differential operators are in an arbitrary orthogonal coordinate system. Let's look at the gradient first. So imagine we have a scalar function f of u, v, and w. We know that the meaning of the gradient is that the gradient of f dot a hat dl is equal to df dl in the direction of the unit vector a hat. So let's take our a hat to be a sub u hat. And that's the direction we move when we change only the u coordinate. So what will be the change in f, df? Well, that will be the partial derivative with respect to u of f times the change in u, du. And what will dl be? dl, well, this is where we have the definition of the scale factors. That will be h sub u du. That's the distance we travel when we change the u coordinate by du. So that tells us that the gradient of f would have a u hat component, right? It should be u hat df dl. Well, what is df over dl? Let's see. It would be partial u of f du over dl, which is h u du. The du's cancel. And so this would be then, we would write this as 1 over h u, the partial u of f. And doing that for the other coordinates, then we would have an h hat v, 1 over hv, partial with respect to v of f, and a 1 over hw, partial with respect to w of f. And so that would be our gradient in an arbitrary orthogonal coordinate system. Now let's look at divergence. And remember that we can think of divergence as deflux, d-volume is equal to the divergence of the vector field A. So let's draw coordinates here, u, v, and w. And like we did in discussing the divergence theorem, let's imagine a box defined by coordinate changes du, dv, and dw. Now, we got to bring in the scale factors, because if we change the coordinate u by amount du, we're going to get a distance hu du. And if we change v by dv, we're going to get hv dv. And if we change w by dw, we're going to get hw dw. So that gives us the sides of the box there. And now let's think about the flux in the w direction. So over on the left side, let's see, we'll have the component that will contribute to that flux will be the AW component. All right, so at every point in space, we're going to write A as AU hat AU plus AV hat AV plus AW hat AW. And in this case, the flux in on the left side is going to be AW times this area, surface area here. And that's going to be HU, HV, DU, DV. That's the flux in. Now over here, we're going to have a flux out. And what will that be? Well, if in moving this distance HW, DW along the W axis, AW, HU, and HV don't change, it would be just the same thing. We'd have the same flux out as the flux in. Right, so it would be, if nothing changed, we would have the same value, AW, HU, HV, DU, DV, but either AW or HU or HV or any combination can change with the coordinate W changing. So we have to add in that change. That would be the partial derivative with respect to W of AW, HU, HV times the change in the coordinate W. And then times the du and dv, which doesn't change, which is constant for the whole system. So the net flux is the flux out minus the flux in. And that just cancels those terms there. And so it leaves a contribution to the net flux through the surface of partial derivative with respect to W of HU, HV, AW, and then times DU, DV, DW. Now, doing similar analysis for the U and the V directions, we get terms that look like partial derivative with respect to V of HW, HU, AV times DU, DV, DW, plus partial derivative with respect to U of HV, HW, AU times DU, DV, DW. And that's got to be deep psi, the flux, has to be divergence of A times the volume. So this has to be the divergence of A times the volume of the box. What's the volume of the box? The product of these three sides. That'll be HU, HV, HW, DU, DV, DW. And so with that, we get then dividing through by the volume, we get that the divergence of A is equal to, the DU, DV, DW will cancel on both sides. We'll get a factor of 1 over this product of the scale factors. And so we'll get 1 over HU, HV, HW times the U derivative of HV, HW, AU plus the V derivative of HW, HU, AV plus the W derivative of HU, HV, AW. And that would be the divergence in an arbitrary orthogonal coordinate system. The Laplacian of a scalar is the divergence of the gradient of the scalar. We've already worked out the gradient and the divergence. And so it's just straightforward. You just plug and chug, and this is what you get. 1 over HU, HV, HW times the U derivative of HV, HW over HU times the U derivative of F plus the V derivative of HW, HU over HV times the V derivative of F plus the W derivative of HU, HV over HW times the W derivative of F. And so that is the Laplacian. And finally, let's look at the curl of a vector field. So let's use the similar picture to what we had when we were talking about Stokes' theorem. So let's say we work in the UV plane here, and we imagine a little piece of this surface that is defined by having coordinate changes du and dv in the u and v coordinates. So what we want to do is try to calculate the integral around the loop that bounds this little rectangle of a dot dl. So let's see. If we change u by du, then the length change would be hu du. And if we change v by dv, the length change would be hv dv. So down here on this bottom side, the component of A that is in the direction of dl would be the u component. So we would have, down here, we would have a contribution au, and then times the distance, which would be hu du. Over here on the left side, the component that's tangential to the direction, v, would be the av component. And this distance here along the v-axis would be hv dv. So that would be av hv dv. Now, what about up here on the top? Well, if au and hu did not change with the coordinate v, then this whole thing would just move up there, be the same, exact same value. So we would have AU, HU, DU. But AU and HU may change with V. So that would add a term, the partial derivative with respect to V of AU, HU times the change in the V coordinate, DV. And then we'd have still the DU. And likewise over here on the right, if HV and AV did not change with respect to the coordinate u, then that would just get that same value over here on the right, AV, HV, DV. But if they do change with the coordinate u, we would get a partial derivative with respect to u of AV, HV, times the change in the coordinate u, du, and then we would still have the DV. So now let's sum up the line integral around this loop. So down here we would get AU, HU, DU, and up on this side we would get plus AV, HV, DV, plus partial U, AV, HV, DU, DV. Now on this side, because we're going to integrate in that direction, we're going in the opposite direction here, so we'll get a minus sign. We'll get minus AU, HU, DU, and minus partial derivative of V, HU, AU, D, dv du. And then going down here on the left side, again, we're going in the opposite direction of the arrow we drew, so we'll get a minus av hv dv. Okay, so let's see what we get. Well, here's av hv dv with a minus sign. Here's the same thing with a plus, so those cancel. And here's, likewise, AU, HU, DU, and here's the minus of that. And so what we end up with, the net value, is, we'll write it this way, the derivative with respect to U of HV, AV, minus the derivative with respect to V, of HU AU times DU DV. These both have a DU DV factor there. And what should that be? Well, that should be the component of the curl of A that's normal to this plane, which would be the AW component. So this dot AW hat times the area of the little surface piece. And what is that area? Well, it would just, it'd be the product of these two displacements. It would be HU, HV, DU, and DV. So the W component of the curl of A would be, well, we would just divide both sides by this, HU, HV, DU, DV. That would cancel this DU, DV here and bring a 1 over HU, HV term. And if we did that for not just the UV plane, but also for the VW plane and the WU plane, we could get all three components of the curl of A. Carrying through with those operations, we end up with this expression. The curl of A is, well, it has an AU hat component, which is 1 over HV HW times partial with respect to V of HW AW minus the partial with respect to W of HV AV, plus an A hat V component divided by HW HU times partial with respect to W HU AU minus partial with respect to U of HW AW plus an A hat W component over HU HV partial with respect to U of HV AV minus partial with respect to V of HU AU. So now, in any orthogonal coordinate system, we can calculate the unit normal vectors, and we can calculate the gradient, the divergence, the Laplacian, and the curl.